My name is Dacia Clay. I'm the audio librarian here at Classical 91.7. While I'm a real librarian, I have a deep, dark
secret.
I know very little about classical music. I grew up listening to rock, and I know something about jazz. But when it comes to classical, but I really want to learn. So, every week on this show, a classical music expert will give me a piece of classical music they think I should know, and then we'll discuss it. Come learn with me in the classical classroom. Hello, everyone, and welcome to the Classical Classroom. I'm Dacia Clay, and I'm happy to welcome back pianist Simone Dinnerstein, who is joining us all the way from the ranch in Beacon, New York. Simone is a graduate of Juilliard. She founded the Neighborhood Classics and started the Bach Packing Initiative, which we talked about on our last episode with her. Both of these initiatives have brought classical music to schools and neighborhoods. In addition to playing all over the U.S. and around the world with virtually every symphony you've ever heard of, she plays concerts for the Piatigorsky Foundation, which brings music to non-traditional venues like prisons. She's got a new CD out called Broadway-Lafayette. Simone, welcome back to the program.
Thanks. It's great to be back.
So what are you going to be teaching me about today?
Well, I think we're going to talk about George Gershwin today.
Nice. I'm very curious about him, so I'm pretty excited about this conversation.
Yeah. Well, George Gershwin was from an immigrant family. He was born Gershwitz and lived in New York City, born in Brooklyn, mm-hmm. turn of the century. I think he died in, maybe I should know the exact date, but it was in the 1930s that he died, mm-hmm. and he was only 38 years old.
Whoa.
Yeah, it was really tragic. He had a brain tumor.
Oh, my gosh.
Yeah. And he was known really primarily for his writing for Tin Pan Alley. I mean, his songs, of course, so many classic songs that he wrote, and then his opera, Porgy and Bess, and he collaborated often with his brother Ira. Mm-hmm. Ira wrote the lyrics. He would write the music. And in fact, an interesting little trivial fact, my mother, who was also born in Brooklyn, as I was, grew up in Sheepshead Bay in Brooklyn. Mm-hmm. And she went to the opening of her high school in her neighborhood that was opened when she started high school. It was called Sheepshead Bay High School, and it was called the Gershwin High School.
Really?
And Ira Gershwin came to that opening ceremony, and she got to meet Ira Gershwin. So
wow.
I'm like, three handshakes away from George.
I wonder how Kevin Bacon is involved in that relationship. I feel like he could be.
Kevin Bacon.
Yeah, you know, the 6 degrees of Kevin Bacon.
Oh, yes, yeah. Of course.
Sorry. I had no idea he had died so young. That's crazy.
Yeah.
Well, what makes Gershwin's music so unique? It's like when I hear Gershwin, I mean, my, you know, untrained ear, like I would not necessarily even say, oh, that's classical music, except that's what other people call it. So can you talk about that a little?
Well, I mean, we should be specific here because we're talking about the Rhapsody in Blue as opposed to the songs.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I'm not talking about The Man I Love or something like that. I'm talking about a concerto that he wrote for piano and orchestra,
mm-hmm.
called the Rhapsody in Blue. I don't think that many people would call his music classical, and this really leads us into the question of what is classical music,
yeah.
and what do we mean by that? I mean, really, I think of classical music as being art music,
mm-hmm.
which is music that's serious, that's not only written for entertainment,
mm-hmm.
that has multiple layers, that has craft involved.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, you could say the same thing about Led Zeppelin.
Right, I was just thinking Radiohead,
yeah.
I mean, or
Radiohead,
yeah.
or you know, Bohemian Rhapsody.
Right, you know? Yeah, that's really very crafted.
There's virtuosity in Bohemian Rhapsody. Mm-hmm. There's many different sections that are doing different things. I mean, the Rhapsody in Blue is a very episodic piece of music. Mm-hmm. There are many different sections, and each section has a different tune, a different kind of style, different kind of rhythm.
Yeah.
And that's also typical of popular music to do something like that. But I think, first of all, I think the idea that it's an instrumental piece connects it more to classical music. You know, there's no words involved. And then there's also a virtuosity element to it. I mean, all the different kinds of techniques that you could use to show off the range of the piano as an instrument are used, as well as the instruments in the orchestra. I mean, the opening clarinet solo is really the most famous clarinet solo, and has this fantastic glissando that, you know, just kind of wails. And every member of the orchestra is challenged in this piece in a way. Their instrumental playing is challenged.
Your new CD kind of looks at the relationship between France and the U.S. and Gershwin as a major part of sort of the lens that you're looking at that musical relationship through. What connections did Gershwin have to France, and like, how can we hear that in his music?
Well, Gershwin was very much influenced by French composers such as Ravel and Debussy. Mm-hmm. He liked the colors of their music and the style, really. I mean, I think that Gershwin was influenced also by the values of French writing. Mm-hmm. In French writing of that time, you know, Ravel, Debussy, Poulenc, all those people, is quite rhythmic. There's a kind of interest in the machine age. So you can hear a lot of mechanical elements in the music, like the Rhapsody in Blue. There's a part towards the end which is sounds like a train starting. The engine starts and it gets rolling, and you hear that kind of mechanical sound of a train on the tracks. So I think that those are interesting connections between French music and what Gershwin was doing. And then the idea of colors and how every instrument has a different color is really present. Now, Gershwin didn't orchestrate the Rhapsody in Blue.
Really?
It was initially orchestrated by Paul Whiteman for his band, but then it was orchestrated by Groffé, and that's the version that I played. It's a symphony orchestra. Mm-hmm. But they're really interesting orchestrational choices. For instance, there's a banjo in it. I recorded this in Leipzig, and let me tell you, finding a banjo player in Leipzig was a bit of a challenge. So the banjo is important, and there are saxophones in the orchestra too, you know, more than one.
That's uncommon.
So these ideas about instruments and how every instrument has a different kind of color sound characteristic. I think that that's something that is also of great value in French writing. And in Ravel's Piano Concerto, he has a harp that plays a really important role. And the English horn has a very important role. I think that, on the other hand, the French composers were really influenced by American music and by jazz, and the whole jazz age influenced them. And you'll hear foxtrots and cakewalks and all sorts of interesting things that they took from American popular music.
Well, now Gershwin, he went to France, right? He met Ravel while he was there. Is that right?
Yes, he did. And his trip to France was immortalized in his piece An American in Paris.
Yeah, which is a really cool piece.
It's a great piece.
There are car horns in it.
Yes, the taxis. You hear the sounds of the taxi horns.
Yeah, that's so cool. I mean, that's such a direct example of how you can feel, you can hear the French influence in his music. It's literally about going to Paris. I was kind of thinking about that concept of, you know, him being so influenced by the French and you know, being so moved that he wrote An American in Paris. Do you think that you know, he has this reputation of being this, you know, quintessentially American composer. Does this French influence detract from that sort of idea of him? Does it add to it? What do you think about that?
No, I think that it just adds another layer to it. I think that Gershwin really wanted to be accepted by the sort of serious concert-going community, the classical concert-going community.
Yeah.
And there have been many different stories about how he asked Ravel to teach him, how he asked Schoenberg to teach him. I mean, I don't know how many of these stories are apocryphal, but I think without a doubt, you know, the fact that he wrote the Rhapsody in Blue and then the Concerto in F and then the opera Porgy and Bess, he wanted to be part of that world, the art music world. And I think that that's interesting that he wanted to stretch himself in that way. There are really, really few composers that cross all of those different worlds. I mean, to me, the most obvious example of somebody who did that was Leonard Bernstein, because he wrote music for, you know, he wrote Mass, he wrote like concertos, and then he wrote West Side Story and Candide, which exists as an opera but also as a musical theater version. So there aren't that many people that know sort of how to cross between the popular music language and the concert music language.
Yeah.
And I think that Gershwin, he really, with something like the Rhapsody in Blue, I think it's actually really hard to categorize what it is. I couldn't really tell you if I felt that it was an art music piece or a popular piece.
Yeah.
I do think it's a very complex piece. And I think that sometimes because it's been, you know, it has so many incredible melodies in it. Mm-hmm. And people think of all the melodies and it's used on, you know, airlines and commercials and all that. People use these melodies. But actually, there's a lot going on beyond the melodies. I mean, the melodies are amazing, but the rhythm in that piece is amazing. I mean, the sense of pulse and where the pulse is and this kind of feeling the music on the back of the beat, all of those syncopations are really subtle and interesting, and the relationship rhythmically between the piano and different members of the orchestra is really unusual, and just the kind of contrapuntal writing is complex. I mean, there's a lot going on in that piece beyond the melody.
You know, you're saying that, like, it's kind of uncommon that he was able to traffic in sort of the language of popular music and concert music. And, you know, that made me think of people who are working today, like Missy Mazzoli, Nico Muli, like Missy Mazzoli, you know, she writes operas, she writes concert music, but she also is in a band, which could arguably be called an ensemble, and people like Bryce Dessner, who play in the National, but who also compose albums of concert music. You know, I wonder if those people are kind of part of Gershwin's musical lineage in a way.
Yeah, I think that's a really good point. I mean, I actually hadn't even thought about that whole wing of music, which is true. There is now this connection between certain singer-songwriters or band, you know, with bands, mm-hmm. and contemporary classical music. For sure, that has become an interesting connection. And you're right. I think that does come from Gershwin originally. Maybe Leonard Bernstein came to mind for me because I was thinking his tradition really comes from jazz.
Yeah.
And I think that Gershwin also was coming from jazz.
Yeah.
And I was not thinking about rock at all, but that's true.
But that, yeah, that, because I mean, that was kind of like the popular music of the day.
Mm-hmm.
And now,
yes.
You know, it's more, there's so many different kinds of popular music. Have, you know, there's, you know, you've got hip hop, you've got indie music, you've got, you know, electronica. And so there are all of these different sort of varieties of popular music to sort of draw mm-hmm. from. But that was the popular music of his day. Like, I'm betting if indie music was available at his time, Gershwin would totally have been into it.
Yeah, I think so. I mean, and you know what's interesting is that I just was thinking about this while you're saying this, but when I was a kid, so like when I was, say, 12, around that age, I remember playing Gershwin, the piano, the preludes for piano. And I remember that that was music that my peers related to more than any other music that I played.
Huh.
Like, in other words, if I played Mozart, they just totally didn't get it.
But
if I played Gershwin, they did. And now I've noticed that if I play Gershwin for school kids, mm-hmm. they don't get it. No. And I wonder if that's something either I was just kind of oblivious to it when I was a young teenager and they didn't get it then either, or whether just music has moved so far away from Gershwin that it's as foreign to them as Mozart.
Yeah. I mean, I would, as a person who does not come from a classical music background, yeah, absolutely. Gershwin is, I guess there's for me, like a little bit more familiarity because I just happened to have an interest in jazz and started listening to it when I was a teenager. But so I can kind of sense some of those undertones in his music. And like you said, I mean, Gershwin just, you know, is so pervasive in our popular culture that he seems a little more approachable. But generally speaking, yeah, I don't understand his music in the same way that I don't necessarily understand the music of Mozart. Like, I'm trying to understand both kinds of music in the same way, or both composers'
yes.
music. Yeah,
it's hard to find the language for it, I think.
Yeah.
On the other hand, my son, who pretty much doesn't like classical music, loves the Rhapsody in Blue. That's the only piece he really loves
I
do.
That's cool. Well, thank you for being here. I mean, our discussion was really brief, but I feel like I have a new understanding of who Gershwin was and kind of where he was coming from. So thanks
Great.
For teaching me about that.
Thank you. It was really fun to talk with you.
All right. We hope you come back again sometime. Take care, Simona.
Okay, you too.
Right, bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
All right, everybody. That about does it for this episode of Classical Classroom. For more Classical Classroom, go to houstonpublicmedia.org/classroom, or you can check us out on SoundCloud at soundcloud.com/classicalclassroom. You can keep up with us on social media, on Twitter and the Tumblr. Or you can send me a good old-fashioned email at dclay@houstonpublicmedia.org. You can listen to us on Stitcher and TuneIn on your mobile device, or you can subscribe on iTunes. However you listen, make sure you rate and review us so that we can dominate the world. Thanks today to audio producer Todd Teeny Hulslander for making us sound so good. Thanks to program director Sinjin Flynn for having the worst fake Texas accent I've ever heard. Thanks to Mark DiClaudio for his piercing hazel eyes. Thanks to Simone Dinnerstein for coming back to this show. Thanks to me for saying words. But most of all, thanks to you for listening. We'll catch you next time.